Hello, good afternoon students. How are you? How you are enjoying your COVID holidays? Stay home, stay safe. I hope all is well. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, yesterday madam discussed about the scalp, and today's topic is face. The face is nothing but the anterior part of the head, and it is occupied by many important orifices, that is oral orifice, nasal orifice, and orbital orifice. All these are very, very important for respiration, for eating, and vision. Because of this reason, face is very, very important in our clinical practice. Okay, here the face, in the human beings, the face is highly developed, and in lower animals, it is not much developed. At the same time, the structure of the face is also different in lower animals and compared with the human beings. That is, in pronograde animals, that is like lower animals, that is elongated. Anterior part of the face is elongated, but in human beings, it is flat. And here, face again, it is the mouth, it is guarded by lips, and the palpebral fissure, that is guarded by eyelids, and nose, anterior nares are also present in the face. Next, why you're supposed to know about the face as a medical student? That is very, very important, because you are in our routine day-to-day practice, we are seeing many complaints related with the face. That is, suppose if you take simple acne. Acne, it is nothing but the infected or inflamed sebaceous gland, which is present in the face, and it is mostly its secretions are regulated by the hormones. That is why the acne are more common in adolescent age. That is the most important thing. Next, apart from this, there are many reasons to know about the face. That is, in some individuals, there may be chances for the development of the weakness of the one side of the face. That is called Bell's palsy. And another one, if you take the facial artery. The facial artery, it is a very important artery, and it is also called anesthetist artery, because during surgeries, the facial artery pulsations are very much helpful for the anesthetist to assess the patient's status. That is the person who is under surgery. That is why that is also very, very important. And guarding of the orifices to prevent entry of foreign objects, and taking food, and vision, and closing eyes from, and protecting the eyes from bright light. These are all the functions which are performed by the hand, by the all these orifices, and they are guarded by with the help of the some structures. That is why you are supposed to know about the face. First, you see about the what is. Face is the anterior aspect of the head, from the forehead to form the chin, and from the on both sides ears. That is, above it is guarded by the hairline margin, and below it is formed by chin and the base of the mandible. On both sides it is formed by ears, or that is also called pinna or external ear. Basic shape of the face is determined by the underlying bones. Already you know that is the bones which are forming the frontal eminence, and the bones which are forming zygomatic eminence, the bones which are taking part in the alveolar process of the upper and lower alveolar processes, and the bone which is taking part in the formation of the zygomatic arch, all these structures, they're determining the shape of the face. Growth of the face bones takes place longer than those and compared with the calvaria. That is, the calvaria means that is the the bones which are forming the neurocranium, that is, it is protecting the brain. The bones which are forming the face, they're also called splanchnocranium. The splanchnocranium means the bones which are forming the face. They are 14 in number, including the mandible. And the bones which are taking part in the formation of the neurocranium, that is the cranial cavity which it protects the brain, they are called neurocranium. Okay, that is the basic information about the osteology of the head and neck, that is especially the skull and the calvaria. And the ethmoid bone, orbital cavities, and the superior part of the nasal cavities have nearly completed their growth by the age of 7 years. And here, there are some peculiarities related with the face structure. That is, it is highly vascular, just like our scalp, and gives best result in the facial surgeries. That is, plastic surgeries which are performed on the face, they are giving best results because of the presence of the high vascularity. And it is also having disadvantage due to high vascularity. That is, if there is any injury to the face, it bleeds profusely. And at the same time, because of the attachment of the facial muscles to the skin, it also produces gaping between the two edges of the injuries, and it leads to more loss of blood with the simple injuries. That is a disadvantage with the high vascularity. And next one is the rich in sebaceous and sweat glands. That is, sweat glands and sebaceous glands, especially the sebaceous glands, are more important clinically, because they are repeatedly, they are getting infected by the bacteria, and they leads to formation of a clinical condition that is called acne. There are different types of acne. When you go to the clinicals, you can learn. But next is the other important thing. The facial skin is thick and elastic. Wounds of the face tend to gape and bleed profusely. And the skin is lax. The facial skin is lax. This permits rapid spread of edema, but it is tightly adherent over the cartilages. That is, over the nasal cartilage or the auricular cartilages. Because of this reason, if there is any boils or abscess in the over the nose as nasal cartilage or over the auricular cartilage, they produce severe pain because of the tightness of the skin over the cartilages. And here, because of the loose lax of the skin of the face, the infection, the inflammation spreads very easily. You can observe during the wasp sting or bite or a bee sting bite. That is the best example. And next is the superficial fascia is absent in eyelids. There, because of this reason, there is no fat in the eyelids, and more in infants. That is very, very important for the infants for suckling the milk from the mother's breast. Next, the deep fascia is absent except the parotid fascia. That is the parotid fascia. It is nothing but the modification of deep cervical fascia. It encircles the parotid gland. That is the only part which is present in the face, that is a parotid fascia. Except that, there is no deep fascia in the face. Next, relatively large size of the buccal pad of fat in infants prevents collapse of cheeks during suckling and produces their chubby appearance. That is due to deposition of abundant amount of fat in the infants. The face is playing most important role in communication, that is interpersonal communications. The face is playing most important role. Our interactions with others take place largely via the face. That is why the facial expressions are very, very important, because without knowing about the inner feeling of the person, just by seeing the expressions of the person, you can assess the person's feelings. That is why this is called, face is the index of mind. All these are due to the contractions and relaxations of the muscles which are attached to the facial skin. Because the facial muscles, they're all developed morphologically, they are the remnants of the panniculus carnosus. pinnacles carnosus, it is present well developed in the lower animals, and it forms the cutaneous muscles. Here in the human beings, it is a very little part of the pinnacles carnosus exists, and that is in the form of some part of the muscles, that is facial muscles and the platysma. These are all nothing but the remnants of the facial muscles. And next, embryologically, the facial muscles are developed from the second branchial arch, that is the mesoderm of the second branchial arch. And functionally, the facial muscles are playing most important role in regulating the orifices like oral cavity, that is orifice, oral orifice and nasal orifice and orbitals and ear. All these orifices, they are guarded by the facial muscles. Here, the contractions and relaxations of the facial muscles are producing the increase or decreasing the size of the orifices. Our facial expressions are the side effects of the contractions and relaxations of these facial muscles. They move the skin and change facial expressions to convey mood. Most muscles are attached to bone or fascia and produce their effects by pulling the skin. All the facial muscles are developed from second pharyngeal arch, already you know. That is because of this reason, all the muscles are supplied by facial nerve. This is the seventh cranial nerve. This is very, very important nerve. It is coming out from the cranial cavity through the stylomastoid foramen. Then it enters into the parotid gland. Then it divides into branches. Then we see later. Okay, what are the different branches? All these things we discuss in detail. Next, to the facial muscles surrounds the facial orifice. That is, they are surround the mouth, they surround the eyes, they surround the nose, serve as sphincters, dilatal mechanisms, and also produce facial expressions. The facial muscles are classified into muscles of the scalp, muscles of the forehead, around the eyebrows, and muscles of the orbital opening, muscles of the nose and ears, muscles of the mouth, lips and cheeks. Here, these are all the list of the facial muscles, that is, occipitofrontalis, that is, here another one point you must remember, that is the forehead. The forehead, it is the common part of the face and the scalp. It is the face and the scalp, both are sharing the forehead. That is occipitofrontalis, you know, that is one of the muscle of the scalp muscle. It is attached to the supraciliary arch. Next muscle is the orbicularis oculi, that is around the eye. And this is also very, very important muscle. It protects the eyes from the bright light, and it also protects the eyes from the foreign bodies. That is why this is also very, very important. And we are in closing the eyes. And this orbicularis oris muscle is very important because it is also divided into three parts. That is, one is the orbital part, another one is the lacrimal part, and next is the palpebral part. Here, each muscle part is having its own action. And we see later what are the different expressions which are produced with the different muscles. Next is the corrugator supercilii, and this is also one muscle, and the procerus nasalis, that is the transverse and compressor nasalis, zygomaticus minor and major, and levator labiae superioris, aliquot nasi, levator labiae superioris, orbitalis, orbicularis oris, buccinator. And these are all the muscles you can see here. That is the uppermost one is the occipitofrontalis. Next is the circular around the eye. There is a circular muscle, that is orbital part of the orbicularis oculi. And just below that is over the eyelid, there is another muscle, that is the palpebral part of the orbicularis oculi. And there is a small part, that is the medial angle of the eye. There is a small part of this orbicularis oculi muscle that is called lacrimal part. And this lacrimal part, it regulates the opening of the lacrimal puncta into the lacrimal sac. So that is why these are all the three muscles, the three parts of the orbicularis oculi muscle. And next is the levator anguli oris. Next is the risorius, depressor anguli oris, depressor labiae inferioris, mentalis, platysma, and auricularis, superior, anterior, and posterior. These are all the different muscles which are present in the face. And Next is the, what are the muscles which are producing different facial expressions and which action? That is, first one is the occipitofrontalis muscle. It elevates the eyebrows and it produces wrinkles over the forehead. And during expression is surprise or curiosity. Surprise or curiosity, that is the occipitofrontalis muscle. Next is the orbicularis oculi muscle, and it closes the eyelids. And here the palpebral part, it is for the gentle closure of the eyelids, and orbital part, it is for the forceful closure of the eyes. That is during sleep, that is only palpebral part is comes into action because we are gently closing the eyes. And during the forceful closure, that is the orbital part of the orbicularis oculi, it comes into action. That is a blinking or winking of the eyelids. Next, corrugator supercilii, it draws the eyebrows medially and inferiorly. And it produces vertical wrinkles above the nose. Worry or concern like this. Okay, that is the expression. Next, procerus and transverse nasalis depresses the medial end of the eyebrow, that is wrinkles skin or dorsum of the nose, that is disdain or dislike, like this. And next is the another important muscle, that is a depressor nasi. It depresses the ala laterally and dilates the nasal aperture, that is flaring of the nose, like this during anger and exertion. Okay. Next muscle is the orbicularis oris, and it is sphincter of mouth compresses the and protrudes the lips. Protrusion of lips during kissing and resist distension when blowing, like this. Okay, next levator labiae superioris. This is also another muscle and dilator of the mouth and retraction or avert upper lip. That is depends upon the mood, and the labial sulcus like this during sadness. Okay, zygomaticus minor, that is another muscle, dilator of the mouth, and it also produces the another sadness expression. Like this, there are so many muscles. All these muscles you see in the figure later. Next is the, what is the nerve supply of the face? That is very, very important clinically, because if there is any injury to the nerves which are supplying to the facial muscles, it leads to paralysis of the muscles which are supplying to the, which are present in the face, and it leads to its own manifestations clinically. That is why the innervation of the facial muscles is very, very important. The face is supplied by 13 nerves. That is, out of these 13, 12 are sensory nerves and one is motor nerve. The sensory branches are from trigeminal nerve. That is, again, you know, the trigeminal nerve, again, it is divided into three parts. That is, ophthalmic, maxillary, mandibular. All three divisions of the trigeminal nerve, they supply sensory nerves, they receive nerve sensory nerves from the face. And the motor supply is by the facial nerve. And there is another important nerve that is coming from the cervical plexus, that is a great auricular nerve. These are all the, all total, that is 11 branches. That is facial nerve is one, the remaining all are sensory. Like first you see about the motor. The facial nerve emerges on the anterior border of the parotid gland, where it divides into five terminal branches. That is, the five terminal branches, we go in different directions. We see the direction of the C. You see here, if you keep the hand like this, for this, and this, you can see the direction of the they pass in different directions. That is, upper one is the temporal branch, and it goes to the temporal muscle, temporalis, temporal area, and it emerges from the superior border of the parotid gland and supplies the auricularis, superior and anterior and frontal belly of the occipitofrontalis muscle and superior part of the orbicularis oris muscle. That is the temporal. Next, you can see this is the direction of the muscles, nerve fibers, nerve branches. And next here, within the parotid gland, facial nerve, it divides into, first it divides into two divisions. That is, one is temporofacial division, and another one is the cervicofacial division. from the temporofacial division, again, there are two branches. That is, one is the temporal branch, another one is the zygomatic branch. From the facial cervicofacial branch division, there are three nerves. Out of this, buccal branch is one, marginal mandibular, and cervical branches. These are the three branches from the cervicofacial division and two branches from the temporofacial division. Total five branches from the facial nerve. And next you see the zygomatic nerve. It runs along the zygomatic arch and supplies the inferior part of the orbicularis solis and other facial muscles inferior to orbit. Next is the buccal branch, divides into upper and lower. Upper buccal branch passes above the parotid duct and supplies zygomaticus major and minor and levator anguli, oris, levator labiae superioris and levator labiae lacunae and muscles of the nose. And lower buccal branch, it passes below the parotid duct, supplies the orbicularis oris. Here in the face, the buccal nerve branches relations with the parotid duct is very, very important during some surgeries. So that is why you must have an idea about the which nerve is above the parotid duct, which nerve is below the parotid duct. And next is the marginal mandibular nerve. Actually, it appears in the neck and then it supplies to the trisorius, depressor anguli oris, depressor labiae inferioris, and mentalis. Here, this marginal mandibular nerve, it is very, very important because actually it goes into the cervical region, then it ascends anteriorly, forwards and superiorly, then again it enters the face at the level of the anteroinferior angle of the mentalis, masseter muscle. This area is very, very important because this is the site for the facial artery also and common facial vein. These are the three most important structures, that is one vein, one artery, and one nerve. There are three are very closely related at this level, that is at the anteroinferior angle of the masseter. Okay, that is why this relation is very, very important anatomically. While performing any surgeries related to this area, you must be aware of these three structures. That is, you must avoid damage or injury to these structures. That is very, very important. And next one is the cervical branch. It appears in the anterior triangle of and supplies to the platysma muscle. The platysma muscle, it is also a remnant of the panniculus carnosus and it is a cutaneous muscle. And next, coming to the sensory branches. The sensory branches are, that is, there are branches from the fifth cranial nerve, that is the trigeminal nerve. The fifth cranial nerve, trigeminal nerve divides into three branches. Three divisions, that is ophthalmic division, maxillary division, and mandibular division. Three divisions, they supply to the face. And the major part is supplied by this one. And skin over the angle of the mandible, just posterior area, over the mandible angle of the mandible only, it is supplied by the great auricular nerve. That is the branch from the cervical plexus, that root value is C2. You can see here, these are all the ophthalmic division, maxillary division, and mandibular division, distribution of all the area of the face. That is, upper one is the ophthalmic division, and lower middle one is the maxillary division, and lower one is the mandibular division supply. And out of these three, here there is another important thing, that is the posterior aspect of the head. It is also supplied by the branches from the cervical plexus. And at the same time, it also receives one important nerve, that is the auricular branch of the vagus nerve to the external acoustic meatus and a small area on the posterior medial surface of the auricle. This auricular branch of the vagus nerve, it is clinically very, very important because if you see in some communities, that is especially Muslims, they used to do some ritual like just before going to take food. That is to stimulate this vagus nerve. If you stimulate the vagus nerve, it increases the gastric secretions and it allows the digestion of food freely. At the same time, in your regular clinical practice, you must be very careful with the auricular branch of the vagus nerve because especially for the ENT surgeons, while syringing the ear with the water, especially you must take warm water, not the cold water. Because the cold water, if you syringe the cold water, it may stimulate the vagus nerve and it may produce cardiac arrest due to vagal stimulation. That is why you must be very careful with the nerve supply of this one. Next is the, first you see the from the ophthalmic nerve division, there are five branches. That is, one is the lacrimal branch, and another one is the supraorbital and supratrochlear, infraorbital and external nasal. These are the five branches they are supplying to the face. Next, from the maxillary nerve, there are three branches. That is, infraorbital and zygomaticofacial and zygomaticotemporal. Here, these three branches, they are supplying to the face, middle part of the face. And in the lower part of the face, that is by the mandibular division, that is auriculotemporal, binds the neck of the mandible, then it passes upwards and it goes into the mandibular area, then it supplies to the auricle, that is the face. Auricular, here it is dividing into, next is the another branch is the buccal branch. It appears in the buccal fat, then it supplies the cheeks and mucous membrane of the vestibule of the mouth. Next is the mental branch. It supplies to the skin and mucosa over the lower lip. Okay, you see, you can see all these branches from the facial nerve, mandibular division, the sensory innervation of the face. Okay, next coming to the another important point, that is arterial supply of the face. The facial artery, it is a branch of the external carotid artery. The face is supplied by three group of arteries. That is, one is the most important source of the face is the facial artery, and next is the transverse facial artery, and another small branches along the branches of the sensory nerves. That is from the ophthalmic and maxillary and mandibular nerves. Along with these, there are some branches also, blood vessels are also coming, especially arteries. They're also supplying to the face. And here, after a loop, the deep part of the submandibular gland, and it enters into the face by winding around lower border of the mandible at the anteroinferior angle of the masseter. The anteroinferior angle of the masseter muscle, it is very, very important clinically, because that is the site for the facial artery. And that is, this is the area you can feel, especially the anesthetist, they can feel these artery pulsations during surgery, because the patient is unconscious and is under the effect of the sedation. Okay, because of this reason, at this level, the masseter, that is a facial artery, you can feel the pulsations. That is why this is very, very important. Next, after that, this artery enters into the face, then it passes tortuously upwards and forwards. Tortuosity of the face, the facial artery, is very, very important, because it is allowing the free movement of the mandible. During free movement of the, during mastication or during speech, if there is no tortuosity, there is a chances for the stretching of the facial artery. To prevent this one, the facial artery is tortuous. In the face, it passes tortuously upwards, forwards, lateral to the angle of the mouth, then ascends to the medial angle of the eye, where it anastomoses with the ophthalmic artery. And here, the facial artery, it is giving branches to the face, that is the inferior labial branch to the lower lip, and superior labial branch to the upper lip, and lateral nasal, that is ala and dorsum of the nose. And here, the inferior labial and superior labial branches are very, very important, because they are supplying to the lower lip and upper lip, and they are anastomosing with the opposite side of the artery of the facial artery. So if you cut the artery at this level, at the labial level, and it may bleed, it may spurt from the both the sides. That is why this is very, very important clinically. Next is the transverse facial artery. This is also one of the artery which is supplying to the face. That is, it is a branch from the superficial temporal artery and passes between the zygomatic arch and the parotid duct and supplies to the parotid gland overlying the skin. Next, small branches from the along the sensory nerves, which are coming from the that is trigeminal nerve. There are supraorbital, supratrochlear, infraorbital, and lateral nasal. Like this, there are so many branches. They are coming to the face, and they're all supplying to the face. Next, coming to the venous drainage of the face. This is also very, very important, because the veins which are draining the face, they're connected deeply into the cavernous sinus. That is why if there is any infection in the face, especially in the lower part of the nose and upper lip, and it may, the infection may go in retrograde direction, and it may spread into the cavernous sinus, and it may produce a clinical condition that is called CSVT, cavernous venous sinus thrombosis. This is the most dangerous disease, and it produces severe pain, headache, vomitings, fever, all these things, and it needs a emergency. It is a medical emergency. That is why the facial vein is a venous drainage of the face is also very, very important. That is the facial vein it is formed. First, it is formed by supratrochlear and supraorbital veins joined together. They form the angular vein, that is at the level of the medial angle of the face. Then here behind the facial artery and reaches the anteroinferior angle of the masseter, and then it runs down, and in the neck it joins with the anterior division of the retromandibular vein to form the common facial vein and drains into the internal jugular vein. Here you can see this is the diagram. First here this is the angular vein, then common facial vein. Next it is joining with the anterior division of the retromandibular vein. Then it is forming the common facial vein and it drains into the internal jugular vein. And next, the retromandibular vein. Here this facial vein communicates with the cavernous sinus through the angular and superior ophthalmic veins. Angular and superior ophthalmic veins, they are the most important veins. They are connecting the facial vein with the cavernous sinus. It is a cavernous venous sinus, and it is the most common cause because these are valveless. That is the another factor. It is predisposing for the transmission of infection from the face into the cavernous sinus. That is why this is very, very important. Next, to coming to the retromandibular vein, this is the another important vein, the superficial temporal vein and maxillary vein. Together, they form the retromandibular vein. The parotid gland, within the parotid gland, the retromandibular vein, again, it divides into two parts, that is anterior and posterior branches. The anterior division of this retromandibular vein joins with the facial vein, and together they form the common facial vein. The common facial vein ultimately it drains into the internal jugular vein. Next is the posterior division joins with the posterior auricular vein to form external jugular vein. Here again, this external jugular vein, it pierces the deep cervical fascia and 2.5 centimeters above the clavicle, and it drains into the subclavian vein. Here, the external jugular vein is also very, very important clinically, because this is the most commonly used vein. Whenever you are unable to get the veins in the limbs, that is due to shock or hypovolemic shock or due to dehydration, there are different reasons for the shock. During this time, we routinely use this external jugular vein for the IV infusions. Here, this is the retromandibular vein, the box, and then it divides into two divisions, that is anterior and posterior divisions. And here, the anterior and posterior divisions joining with the different veins, together they are forming the different veins. Okay, next coming to the another important thing, that is lymphatic drainage of the face. That is the upper area, that is the forehead, lateral halves of the eyelids, conjunctiva, cheek, and parotid region drains into the pre-auricular or superficial parotid lymph nodes. And next is the intermediate area, that is central forehead, frontal sinus, medial half of the eyelids, lateral part of the lower lip and lower jaw drains into the submandibular lymph nodes. And another one is the lower area, it is drains into the submental group of lymph nodes. That is especially the central part of the lower lip and the chin drains into the submental group of lymph nodes. Okay, these are all the lymphatics which are draining into different groups of lymph nodes. You can see here, this is the submental group, and this is the submandibular group, and that is the parotid or pre-auricular group of lymph nodes. Next, coming to the applied anatomy of the face. This is the main important thing. What is the way you're supposed to know as a medical student, like the what is the need to know the about the face? That is very, very important here. The face, first you see one important thing, that is the lesions of the facial nerve. That is very, very important. That is the lesions of the facial nerve. It may be supranuclear or nuclear or infranuclear or peripheral part of the nerve. That is, if it is supranuclear loss of this damage to the facial nerve, it leads to the impairment of the loss of movement of the lower facial muscles of the contralateral. Contralateral means opposite side, but upper facial muscles are escaped. Next, suppose if you take the nuclear paralysis, that means in the pons, that is the nucleus of the facial nerve, if there is a damage due to some other reasons, that is, it may be due to CVA, cerebrovascular accidents, that is especially infarction of the pons. It is the most common cause for the damage to the nucleus of the facial nerve. If there is a damage to the facial nucleus, it leads to loss of movements in the all facial muscles on the affected side. And suppose again, after formation of the facial nerve, it comes out of the cranial cavity through the stylomastoid foramen. And from the stylomastoid foramen, it comes out of the cranial cavity. Immediately after that, it enters into the parotid gland. Okay, here, if there is a damage at this area, leads to a clinical condition that is called facial palsy or Bell's palsy. The Bell's palsy is the most common clinical condition that is resulted due to not only complete damage to the facial nerve, it may also due to inflammation of the facial nerve, that is extracranial part, or due to surrounding structures. So inflammation also leads to compression over the facial nerve, and it leads to development of the paralysis of the facial muscles of the affected side. That leads to Bell's palsy. That is the, you know, already the famous person that is in the NCP leader in the Maharashtra, that is Sarad Pawar. He is a person who is suffering with the Bell's palsy. You can see whenever there is a opportunity in the television. Next is the manifestations of the affected side. That is, what are the manifestations of the affected side due to Bell's palsy? That is, there is a loss of transverse wrinkles of the forehead, and there is a nasolabial folds disappear. Nasolabial folds disappear. Next is the drooping of eyebrows. That is, drooping of eyebrows. That is a falling down of the upper eyelid. And next is the, during smiling, angle of mouth remains motionless. There is no expression during smiling. You are unable to detect the smiling. Due to paralysis of the buccinator, food accumulates in the vestibule of the mouth. Because of this reason, you need repeated oral cavity infections. And next is the labial speech may be affected. That is a slurring of speech, or sometimes there may be dribbling of saliva from the angle of the mouth. Okay, you can see this is the picture. You can see that is the Bell's palsy. That is here, the deviated side is abnormal. Side is abnormal. The dragging side is normal, because the affected side, there is a weakness of the muscles of the face, and they are unable to maintain the tone. Because of this reason, the mouth is deviated towards the normal side. Okay, this is the Bell's palsy. And another clinical condition, that is a trigeminal neuralgia. This is an extremely painful condition of the neurological disorder affecting the trigeminal nerve in the brain. While the root or ganglion of the nerve itself is located near the brainstem, behind the ear, the pain from the irritation of this nerve is felt in the face, gums, tongue, throat, eyes, eyebrows, or lips, depending upon which branch of the nerve is affected. It is thought to be the most painful affection known to humankind. Prognosis is not terminal. Most patients just wish to wear. And you can see here, these are all the different facial expressions. That is occipitofrontalis. It produces surprise and curiosity. And next is the corrugator supercilii. It produces worry and concern. And next is the disdain or dislike, that is a procillus and transverse nasalis muscle. And next is the orbicularis oculi, it produces a blinking or winking of the eyelids. Next is the levator labiae aliquae nasi, that is compressor nares, and it produces flaring like this during anger, flaring of ala of the nose, that is during flaring and during anger. And buccinator and orbicularis oris, this is also another important muscle. It produces protrusion of the lips during kissing, a resistor of blowing. During blowing, it resists the leaking of air. Next is another muscle, that is zygomaticus major and minor. It produces sadness like this, disdain or sadness. And next is the grinning or grimacing, that is a risorius muscle. And next is the risorius and depressor labiae inferioris, grinning and sadness. This is the muscle movement. And another muscle, levator labiae superioris and depressor labiae inferioris, they produce the sadness. And next is the risorius and levator labiae superioris and depressor labiae inferioris, grinning and sadness. And orbicularis oris, it produces protrusion of the lips. And depressor anguli oris, it is sadness like this. And next is the showing about doubt like this. Mentalis is the muscle, it is causing showing up doubt. And next is the conveying tension that is due to platysma. Okay, these are all the muscles, they are producing different facial expressions. And here the face is the index of mind. And here, take home message, what are the things you supposed to learn in the face? That is number one, that course of the facial artery and relation of the facial artery with the masseter muscle, that is the anterior-inferior angle of the masseter muscle. That is very important. And next is the other important thing, that is facial, Bell's palsy or facial palsy. That is the another clinical condition. And next is the trigeminal neuralgia. That is also one of the most important thing, clinical condition. And routinely we are seeing in the clinical practice, that is acne, acne vulgaris. There are different types of acne in the adolescence age. That is due to, mostly these acne depend upon the hormonal changes. And if there is the obstruction to the sebaceous glands and superadded with secondary infection, it leads to the formation of small abscess. Okay, that is also another important clinical condition. And that is another important client. Suppose if there is a damage to the orbicularis or nerves which is supplying to the orbicularis oris muscle, especially the lower part, it may produce a drooping of the lower eyelid, that is called ectropion. That clinical condition is called ectropion. Ectropion means the drooping of the lower eyelid, and drooping of the upper eyelid is called ptosis. Okay, here what is the problem with this drooping of the lower eyelid means? That is the spilling over of the cell, that is tears. That is the most common clinical condition during this condition. That is called epiphora. Epiphora means spilling of the tears from the palpebral fissure. That is very, very important. Spilling over of the tears. Okay, that is the ectropion and epiphora. These are the two most clinical conditions which are related to the inferior part of the orbicularis oculi muscle. Okay, next is the, if there is a damage to the buccinator muscle and it leads to accumulation of food in the vestibule of the mouth. The vestibule of mouth is nothing but the space between the teeth and the gums and inner side of the cheeks. That is the vestibule of the mouth. And sometimes if there is a damage to the paralysis of these muscles, the speech may be affected. And especially it is more common in people who are suffering with the hemiplegia, that is one-sided paralysis. Or it may be in old people also, this is most common clinical condition. There is a spilling of the saliva, that is dribbling of saliva from the mouth. That is also another clinical condition due to weakness of the muscles which are guarding the oral orifice. Okay, all these are the very, very important clinical conditions which are related with the face. And dangerous area of the face, that is also another important point, that is the lower part of the nose and upper lip. this that area from here to here. This area is the called dangerous area of the face. Why it is called dangerous area of the face means that is the veins which are draining this area of the face, they are connected with the deep veins, that is the cavernous sinus, through the angular vein and superior ophthalmic vein. They are draining they are connected with the cavernous sinus, and it leads to development of a dangerous clinical condition, that is a CSVT, cavernous sinus venous thrombosis. That is the most important clinical condition you can see in the some people. That is the thing. Thank you. Bye. Stay home. Stay safe. Take care. ఎవరో హ్యాండ్ రైజ్ చేశారు పవన్
చాట్ పెడతాను ఒకసారి
ఓకే షూర్
ఈ లిస్ట్ ఉంచుకున్నాను పెట్టేసుకుంటాను
ఏంటి
చాట్
any doubt please put in the chat box
then okay meeting start close
close.